Hello and welcome to the Commander's Quarters. I'm your host, Mitch. Glad to have you here. Here at the Commander's Quarters, we're all about Commander on a budget. Today's episode is going to be a $50 deck tech. When I say $50, I mean that is an overall deck cost. Both shipping and commanders that are $10 or less are going to be included in that cost, but basic lands will not be. Decks on this channel are built to be fun, inexpensive, and focused. If you want to learn more about what a focused commander deck is, check out this video here. On this deck tech, I'm going to take you through its strategy, the tactics, and how this deck wins. This show and episodes like this one are possible because of viewers like you. So if you're looking for some easy ways to help support the show, make sure you like this episode and share it with friends. And make sure you subscribe to the channel and hit that bell notification icon so you don't miss any new episodes. You can also go check out our playmats and other merchandise at thecommanderscourters.com. Thank you to everyone who's already purchased our merchandise. It really does help support the channel. Another easy way to support this channel is by using our TCGplayer affiliate links. So make sure that you're looking for those links in the description whenever you're buying a deck or just individual cards. And the final way that you can support this show is by supporting us directly by becoming a patron. There are many benefits to being a patron, and I truly couldn't do this without all of their support. Today's deck tech is on the newly spoiled Syr Konrad the Grim. It's a 5/4 human knight that costs 3 black-black. It has, whenever another creature dies or a creature card is put into a graveyard from anywhere other than the battlefield or a creature card leaves your graveyard, Syr Konrad the Grim deals 1 damage to each opponent. And by paying 1 and a black, each player puts the top card of their library into their graveyard. So Syr Konrad's trigger has a lot of text, so let's break it down. Whenever any creature but Syr Konrad dies, it pings everyone for 1. Whenever a creature card is put into a graveyard from anywhere else, it deals 1 damage to each opponent as well. And then if a creature leaves your graveyard specifically, it's going to deal 1 damage to each opponent. So this commander can definitely be taken in a couple different directions. Aristocrats is definitely one option, but the direction that I want to go with Syr Konrad is mill. I think a commander like Syr Konrad gives you a very unique opportunity to have a very different kind of a deck. On top of its own milling ability, there are plenty of ways that you can mill yourself and your opponents too. And the more creatures that you mill, the more damage you're going to do. So what's our strategy with this deck? We're going to mill everyone and bring our creatures out of the graveyard. We ping our opponents once for each creature that we mill. And we also ping our opponents whenever our creatures leave the graveyard. And then how we win with this deck is pretty simple. We're going to ping down all of our opponents over time or all at once. We've got plenty of ways to mill over time, but we also have some big one-shot effects too. As with all Commander's Quarters decks, I'm going to take you through 10 different tactics that show you how the deck works and how we're going to win with it. So let's get started with tactic number 1 of Rocks and Dorks. First up, there's Wayfarer's Bauble, which we can pay 2 and tap and sacrifice it to search our library for a basic land and put into play tapped. Then we're running 3 mana rocks that each cost 2 and tap for 1 with Fractured Power Stone, Prismatic Lens, and Guardian Idol. And Guardian Idol might enter the battlefield tapped, but we can also turn into a 2-2 for 2. Next up is Unstable Obelisk, which also taps for a colorless, but it costs 3 mana. But we can also pay 7 to tap and sacrifice it to destroy target permanent. Next up, we've got some mana dorks that cost 2 and tap for 1 with Hedron Crawler, Mannequin, and Leaden Mirror. And next up is Milliken, which does the same, but it also mills us when it taps for mana. And finally, there's Palladium Mirror, which does cost 3, but it taps for 2. But now that we've talked about ramping, what kind of spells are we going to be casting? Let's go through some of our mill pieces in tactic number 2, Meet the Millers. First up, we're going to be running Stitcher Supplier and Return Reveler. When Stitcher Supplier enters the battlefield or dies, we put the top 3 cards of our library into our graveyard. So that's a total of 6 cards milled for just 1 mana. And then when Return Reveler dies, each player puts the top 3 cards of their library into their graveyard. So that's going to be a total of 12 milled cards for 2 mana. Next up, there's Eye Collector, which is another new card from Throne of Eldraine. Currently, there isn't a price listed on it, but since it's that common, I can't imagine it'll be a lot. It has flying, and when it deals combat damage to a player, each player puts the top card of their library into their graveyard. So for just 1 mana, we've got the chance to mill 4 cards on each of our turns. Next up is Undercity Informer, which is a fantastic sacrifice outlet in this deck. By paying 1 and sacrificing a creature, target player reveals cards from the top of their library until they reveal a land card, then they put those cards into their graveyard. Now, most of the time, we're going to be targeting ourselves with this. We're running plenty of creatures in this deck, and we've got a lot of ways to get them back. Next up, we've got some continuous mill effects with Blood Curdler and Sewer Nemesis. The first says at the beginning of your upkeep put the top card of your library into your graveyard. Milling ourselves for 1 each turn on a body is a pretty good deal. And if we have Threshold, Blood Curdler gets +1/+1 and at the beginning of your end step, exile 2 cards from your graveyard. Now for the most part, we don't want to exile creatures from our graveyard. But if we need to get some extra damage in with our commander, we can always remove creatures. And then there's Sewer Nemesis, which says when it enters the battlefield, you choose a player. Its power and toughness are going to each be equal to the number of cards in the chosen player's graveyard. And whenever the chosen player casts a spell, that player puts the top card of their library into their graveyard. So with this, the vast majority of the time, we're going to choose ourselves. With the amount that we can mill ourselves, Sewer Nemesis can be a huge threat. And every time we cast a spell, we get to mill ourselves 1. Next up, there's Doom Whisperer, which can be an absolute bomb in this deck. It has pay 2 life, surveil 2. So without paying any mana, we can just keep milling ourselves over and over again. This can be a great way to finish off our opponents if they're low. We can just keep paying 2 life to keep hitting more and more creatures and putting them into our graveyard. And finally, we're running 2 Dredge creatures with Golgari Thug and Stinkweed Imp. Golgari Thug has Dredge 4 and Stinkweed Imp has Dredge 5. So Dredge 5 means that if you would draw a card, instead you may put exactly 5 cards in the top of your library into your graveyard. If you do, return this card from your graveyard to your hand, otherwise draw a card. So essentially you're replacing a draw and milling yourself with one of these. But outside of creatures, we've got other ways to mill too. So let's go through them now in tactic number 3, the local mill. First up, there's Ghoulcaller's Bell, which we can tap to mill everyone for 1. And then Worried Beads has, at the beginning of each player's upkeep, they mill 1. Next up, we've got some utility mill pieces with Codex Shredder, Wand of Vertebrae, and Perpetual Timepiece. By tapping Codex Shredder, we mill someone for 1. And then we can pay 5 to tap and sacrifice it to return target cards from our graveyard to our hand. Although that might seem like a small effect, it can make a huge difference in the game. And then by tapping Wand of Vertebrae, we can mill ourselves for 1. And then if we pay 2 to tap and exile it, we can shuffle up to 5 target cards from our graveyard into our library. Again, for each creature that leaves our graveyard, our commander pings all of our opponents for 1. So if we choose to shuffle back in 5 creatures, we're pinging all of our opponents for 5. That's a total of 15 damage for just 2 mana. And then there's Perpetual Timepiece, which can do this in an even bigger way. We can tap it to put the top 2 cards of our library into our graveyard. And then by paying 2 and exiling it, we can shuffle any number of target cards from our graveyard into our library. Again, with the number of creatures that we can put into our graveyard, this can deal a ton of damage. Next up, we've got some bigger milling effects with Grindclock, Altar of Dementia, and Keening Stone. We can tap Grindclock to put a charge counter on it, and then tap it to make target player put the top X cards of their library into their graveyard, where X is the number of charge counters on Grindclock. Next up, there's Altar of Dementia, which has sacrifice a creature, target player puts a number of cards equal to the sacrificed creature's power from the top of their library into their graveyard. So if one of our creatures is going to die anyways, we can sacrifice them to get more value out of them. And then by paying 5 and tapping Keening Stone, we can make target player put the top X cards of their library into their graveyard, where X is the number of cards in their graveyard. So essentially, this is going to double up the amount that it mills each time. Now, all these are very powerful milling effects, but perhaps the most powerful milling effect in this deck is our Golden Pig. The Golden Pig is going to be the number 1 card out of our 99. And the Golden Pig for this deck is Mindcrank. Mindcrank is an artifact that costs 2, and it says whenever an opponent loses life, that player puts that many cards from the top of their library into their graveyard. This card is extremely synergistic with our commander. For example, let's say that we mill one opponent for 1 card. Our commander is going to trigger and ping all of our opponents for 1. Then Mindcrank is going to trigger and each opponent has to mill 1. For each of those cards that's a creature, our opponents are going to get pinged for 1 more, and Mindcrank will trigger that many times. So essentially, this can keep going until no one mills a creature. Now with this deck, we've got plenty of ways to mill ourselves and our opponents. That means that we can keep triggering this and starting that whole process over and over again. And on top of that, we don't even have to mill to start the process. If any of our opponents lose life while this is in play, it's going to start that whole process on its own. At just 2 mana, this card's extremely efficient and deadly for this deck, and that's why it's the Golden Pig. We're also running a few more cards that can be very deadly on their own. Shared Trauma says, starting with you, each player may pay any amount of mana. Each player puts the top X cards of their library into their graveyard, where X is the total amount of mana paid this way. Now, our opponents might not give us extra mana, but we can still mill everyone a ton. And finally, there's Morality Shift, which can be a game-ending card in this deck. It says exchange your graveyard and your library, then shuffle your library. So essentially, for our commanders in play, our opponents are going to get pinged for every single creature that's in our graveyard and our library, because we've got those creatures leaving our graveyard and our creatures coming into our graveyard, too. Again, this can deal a ton of damage that can easily finish off all of our opponents at once. But we've got more ways to get our creatures out of our graveyard, too. Let's go through them now in tactic number 4, Never Let Go. First up, there's Cadaver Imp, which says, when it enters the battlefield, you may return target creature card from your graveyard to your hand. And then Pit Keeper does the exact same thing, but only if we have 4 or more creature cards in our graveyard. With this deck, that shouldn't be a problem, though. Next up, there's Dutiful Attendant, which says, when it dies, return another target creature card from your graveyard to your hand. And then there's Soul of Innistrad, which can help us get a lot of creatures back with its abilities. By paying 3 black, we can return up to 3 target creature cards from our graveyard to our hand. We can also get the same effect if it's in our graveyard by paying 3 black and exiling it. Next up, there's Nim Devourer, which might seem like an odd include, but can actually be pretty powerful in this deck. By paying black, we can return it from our graveyard to play, and then we sacrifice a creature, but we can only play this ability during our upkeep. So this can be a sacrifice outlet from our graveyard. On top of that, we can actually just return it and sacrifice itself. And that's going to trigger our commander twice. Once for it leaving the graveyard, and once for it going back to the graveyard. So for just 2 mana, we're dealing a total of 6 damage, and that's a repeatable effect. If our opponents are low, we can use this to finish them off out of nowhere. Next up, we've got some ways to reanimate creatures with Phyrexian Delver and Whisper Blood Liturgist. When Phyrexian Delver enters the battlefield, return target creature card from your graveyard to the battlefield, you lose life equal to that card's converted mana cost. That's a very small price to pay, especially since our average converted mana cost is pretty low in this deck. And then Whisper has tap, sacrifice 2 creatures, return target creature card from your graveyard to the battlefield. And remember, with our commander in play, essentially every single time we activate this, we get 3 triggers. But outside of creatures' effects and abilities, we've got other ways to get creatures back too. So it's time to move on to tactic number 5, There and Back. First up, we're running 3 cards that essentially do the exact same thing with Bone Harvest, Foot Bottom Feast, and Grave Purge. They let you put any number of target creature cards from your graveyard on top of your library. Bone Harvest will draw you a card at the beginning of the next upkeep, but Foot Bottom Feast and Grave Purge draw you one right away. Regardless, these cards can deal a ton of damage in a couple of ways. So let's just go through an example with Bone Harvest. Let's say, for example, that you've got 10 creatures in your graveyard. You cast Bone Harvest targeting all 10 of those creatures. Your commander triggers 10 times, dealing 10 damage to each opponent. Then if you can mill yourself for 10, you're going to deal another 10 damage to each of your opponents. If your mill pieces aren't set up, though, you you need to be careful with these cards. You might not want to just draw into creature after creature after creature if they're not ones that you can use. A similar way to go about this is with Empty the Catacombs. It says each player returns all creature cards from their graveyard to their hand. So again, with 10 creatures in your graveyard, you're going to deal 10 damage to each opponent. And for each creature that you discard at the end of the turn, you deal 1 damage too. And on top of that, getting back a ton of key creatures into your hand can be a huge swing too. And finally, there's Wake the Dead, which can be a very impactful card. You can only cast it during combat on an opponent's turn, but that's not a big deal. It says return X target creature cards from your graveyard to the battlefield, sacrifice those creatures at the beginning of the next end step. So basically, you're going to be bringing back creatures, pinging your opponents, and sacrificing them so they ping them again. And on top of that, you get any ETBs or leave the battlefield effects. Plus, since you're casting this during combat, you can use it as a combat trick to get rid of opponent's creatures. But what are some other ways that we have to deal with their creatures? Let's go through them now in tactic number 6, Sacrifices Must Be Made. First up, there's Priest of Forgotten Gods, which can do a lot of work for this deck. It has tap, sacrifice 2 other creatures, any number of target players each lose 2 life, and sacrifice a creature, you add black, and draw a card. This can deal with creatures, ramp us, and draw us cards. And again, anytime that any creature dies, each of our opponents are going to get pinged for 1. So if each opponent has a creature, there's going to be a total of 5 creatures getting sacrificed. And on top of that, we're going to make all of them lose 2 life. So as long as everyone has a creature, in total, every single time we activate this, all of our opponents lose 7 life. And again, on top of that, we're ramping and drawing a card. Next up, there's Flashback Marauder, Merciless Executioner, and Slum Reaper, each which do the exact same thing. When they enter the battlefield, each player sacrifices a creature. So essentially, if everyone's got a creature, again, that's 4 triggers off of our commander. And then Playcrafter is similar, but it has, when it enters the battlefield, each player sacrifices a creature or planeswalker, each player who can't discards a card. Next up, we've got some longer-term sacrifice effects with Anawan the Ruin Sage and Archfiend of Depravity. Anawan says, at the beginning of your upkeep, each player sacrifices a non-vampire creature. And then Archfiend says, at the beginning of each opponent's end step, that player chooses up to 2 creatures they control, then sacrifices the rest. Both these are great ways to work to control the board and deal some extra damage to our opponents each turn. But what are some ways that we're going to get to all these good cards? So let's move on to tactic number 7, Digging It. First up, there's Sign in Blood, which says, target player draws 2 cards and loses 2 life. So we can use this to draw some cards or even finish off an opponent. Next up, there's Siphon Mine, which says, each other player discards a card, you draw a card for each card discarded this way. And remember that if any of those cards are creature cards, our commander's going to trigger. Next up, there's Necrologia, which you can only cast during your end step, and you're going to have to pay X life, but you get to draw X cards. This can be a great way to dig through your deck, but can also be a great finisher too. If you draw into and then have to discard a ton of creatures, you can deal a lot of damage to your opponents. Finally, there's Dark Deal, which is another way that you can deal a lot of damage to your opponents while drawing cards. It says each player discards all the cards in their hand, then draws that many cards minus 1. The more creatures that get discarded, the more damage all your opponents take. But sometimes instead of digging, you want to get a very specific card. Let's go through some ways to do that in tactic number 8, Perfect Pull. First up, there's Mausoleum Secrets, which says, search your library for a black card with converted mana cost less than or equal to the number of creature cards in your graveyard, reveal it, put into your hand, then shuffle your library. With this deck, it won't take us very long to get a ton of creatures into our graveyard. Then we can use this to go get basically any black card in our deck. Another very useful tutor for this deck is Final Parting. It says, search your library for 2 cards, put 1 into your hand, the other into your graveyard, then shuffle your library. So essentially in this deck, this is a tutor with upside. This gets us a card in our hand and a useful creature in our graveyard. But this deck definitely revolves around its commander, so we need to find some ways to protect him. Let's go through some of those ways now in tactic number 9, Hands Off. First up, there's Swiftfoot Boots, which is going to give our commander Hexproof and Haste. That Haste really won't matter too much, but that Hexproof comes in huge. Next up, there's Blessing of Leeches, which has Flash, and it says, at the beginning of your upkeep, you lose 1 life, and you can pay 0 to regenerate enchanted creature. 1 life is a very small price to pay to be able to regenerate our commander for free. Next up, there's No Rest for the Wicked, which can be a huge card for this deck. By sacrificing it, we can return to our hand all creature cards that are put into our graveyard from play this turn. And again, for each one of those creatures that we get back, our commander's going to be dealing damage. And finally, there's Cauldron of Souls, which can have an even bigger impact. By tapping it, we can choose any number of target creatures, and each of those creatures gains persist until end of turn. So when those creatures die, if they didn't have any -1/-1 counters on them, they come right back into play with a -1/-1 counter on it. This not only protects our creatures, but deals extra damage by bringing them back into play. And again, on top of that, we get any ETB triggers too. Now, protecting our commander is great, but what are some ways that we can really take advantage of its effect? Let's go through them now in tactic number 10, Damaging. First up, there's Loxton and Warhammer, which gives our commander lifelink. So each time our commander triggers, we gain 3 life. And with the amount of damage that our commander puts out, that's going to be a ton of life. Next up, there's Nekote, which says, when equipped creature deals damage to a player, that player loses 1 life. So essentially, this just doubles up our commander's effect. But we can make our commander even deadlier with infect with something like Wrathed Exoskeleton or Tainted Strike. Every single time our commander triggers, our opponents are going to get a poison counter. And getting 10 triggers in one turn is very possible for this deck. Tainted Strike especially can finish off our opponents out of nowhere. If someone plays a board wipe and there are enough creatures in play, Tainted Strike can kill all of our opponents at once. But if that doesn't work, we can always finish off our opponents with Gary. In a mono black deck especially, it can drain our opponents for a ton. But now that we've gone through the spells in this deck, let's go on to the mana base. First up, we're going to be running Dakmor Salvage, which enters the battlefield tapped, taps for black, and has dredge too. Next up is Haunted Fengraft, which can tap for a color so we can pay 3 to tap and sacrifice it to return a creature card at random from our graveyard to our hand. Next up is Memorial to Folly, which enters the battlefield tapped, taps for a black, we can pay 2 and a black to tap and sacrifice it to return target creature card from our graveyard to our hand. And then there's Sequestered Snatch, which can tap for a color so we can pay 4 to tap and sacrifice it to put the top 5 cards of our library into our graveyard, then we can put an artifact card from our graveyard back on top of our library. And the rest of our mana base is very simple, we're going to be running 31 Swamps. And now that we've gone through every single card in this deck, let's do a quick price check. A quick reminder that our deck costs are calculated using TCGplayer optimization, optimizing with even heavily played and damaged cards because those cards need a home too. Because this commander is so new, there aren't any decks on EDH Rec yet, but I can pretty much guarantee you that our deck is going to be cheaper than the average at $49.85. Just a quick note that this cost does not include the cost of the Throne of Eldraine cards, and those two cards were the commander itself and Eye Collector. Those prices aren't up yet, so I wasn't able to include them. Again, the price of this deck is the price that I got for it on the day that I'm recording. If you want to see a breakdown of this deck's cost, check out the link in the description. Keep in mind that prices can and will fluctuate and change over time, but with these deck costs, I want to be as transparent as I possibly can. Again, Commander's Quarters decks are built to be tuned and focused within their budget, but there are always ways that we can improve on them. So let's go through some reasonable upgrades now to see what some of those ways just might be. First, let's upgrade this deck by adding in Cabal Stronghold and taking out a Swamp. Having a way to generate some extra mana never hurts. Next up, let's add in Beseech the Queen and take out Necrologia. Beseech the Queen is a fantastic cheap tutor in black. And then we're going to be adding in Basilisk Collar and taking out Locks and Warhammer. This is just a much more efficient way to get that lifelink. Next up, we're going to be adding in Lightning Greaves and taking out Blessing of Leeches. Lightning Greaves is a fantastic piece of equipment that protects our commander very well. And then we're going to be adding in Ultra the Brood and taking out Grind Clock. Ultra the Brood is something that we can put down really early and it can do a ton of work for us. And finally, let's add in Dread Summons and take out Worry Beads. Dread Summons is a very efficient way to mill everyone for a lot and to create some creature tokens too. And with that, our show is coming to a close, but I really want to hear about your thoughts on these picks, so why don't you let me know in the comments below. And make sure that you're following us on social media for more updates and sneak peeks on future episodes. Links to our social media accounts can be found in the description. Also in the description below is a link to the Commander's Quarters Patreon page, and I just want to say a quick thank you to the patrons who have subscribed so far. There are many benefits to being a patron for the Commander's Quarters, including being able to vote on future commanders for deck techs. There's even a general level tier where you get your own personalized deck tech dedicated to you. I truly couldn't do this without all of your support, so from the bottom of my heart, thank you. If you haven't already, make sure that you like and subscribe to the channel. Here at the Commander's Quarters, we're all about budget commander. So while you're at it, go ahead and check out some of our other types of episodes. And with that, I'm out of here. Thanks again, and have a good one.